In the previous lectures, we have learnt about vectors. We have seen how two vectors can be added, how one vector can be subtracted from another vector, and how two vectors can be multiplied. I hope you have understood all this, because now we are in a position to use the vector algebra in mechanics. And the first thing that we do is displacement vector, velocity vector, and acceleration. Suppose you are at the point A, whose position is given by this vector A from the origin to the point where we are located. This is vector A. So, our position vector is A. After some time, suppose we reach the position vector B, then the difference between B and A is known as the displacement vector. Let me show you by this animation. We were at A. After some time, we reach at B, where both A vector and B vector are our positions with respect to a certain coordinate system. Then the difference between B and A, between the final position and the initial position, is the displacement vector B minus A. So, the displacement vector denoted by capital S is equal to vector B minus vector A. It is called displacement vector or simply displacement, but you must remember that it is a vector. Notice that we have not said anything about the path that might be taken between the position A and position B. In fact, if you started at point A, took all kinds of curves and paths and came back to point A, your displacement would be 0, because the difference between the final vector and initial vector is 0. So, your displacement would be 0. So, the path does not matter. What matters is the final position and the initial position, and the difference between these two positions is the displacement vector. That is what matters, not what path we take. In fact, if you go around a circle many times, as a runner does in a race many times, you come back after one circular path, you come back to the same point. So, your displacement is 0. But in one circle, you have covered a distance equal to 2 pi r. If you went n times round this circle and came back to the same point, your displacement will be 0, but the distance covered by you would be 2 pi r times n, the number of rotations that you take. Let us take another graph this time. Displacement time graph again, but in this case the displacement is increasing. And you can, as I have shown you in the earlier slide, the slope is now increasing. Let me remind you, the slope increasing as we move along this axis. Here, the slope is increasing as we move along the time axis. That means, as the time increases, the slope increases, therefore, the rate of change also increases. That means, the velocity increases with time. Now, so far we have dealt with finite quantities, delta S, although small but finite, and delta T, small but finite. And let us take the point P on this curve. If we want to find out the rate of change at P, I draw a tangent to the curve at the point P, then I take delta S by delta T. I can take smaller triangle, delta S by delta T. If I want to find out at the point P, I will have to take a very small triangle, very small delta S and very small delta T. In the limit, this is called ds by dt. So, instantaneous velocity at the point P, not at any other point, at the point P itself, the instantaneous velocity is given by ds by dt, that is the slope at the point P itself. This is a limiting sort of exercise, and we get from V equal to delta S by delta T, this important result that vector V is equal to derivative of the displacement S. So, if I want to find out the instantaneous velocity at any point, I simply take the derivative of S at that point. V at that point would be the derivative ds by dt. About derivatives, if occasion arises, I'll tell you in later lectures. Usually we are interested in instantaneous velocity, as I've been saying, and then we get v equal to ds by dt. And as I've been saying earlier also, velocity is a vector because both sides are vectors. So on this side there is s vector, on this side there is velocity, it must be a vector. And therefore, it would be wrong to say that velocity of a bus is 5.0 meters per second. The correct way would be to say that the velocity of the bus is 5.0 meters per second in the north direction. Remember, vector needs both magnitude and direction for its description. In ordinary life, actually we don't use velocity very much. In ordinary life, we are used to term speed. And what is speed? In the earlier graph I showed you that the path for the displacement, path does not matter. But if we measured the length along the path and denote it by small s, then the speed would be the total distance travelled divided by the total time taken. That is s by t, and s by t is the average speed because we have not taken smaller amounts. We have taken the total distance travelled and divided by the total time taken. If we took small distance and small time, then we will get instantaneous speed ds by dt, where the small s denotes the distance travelled. And you can see ds is not a vector, it is a scalar, it is the distance travelled, length covered, and therefore speed is a scalar. Velocity is a vector, speed is a scalar. What is the relation between these two? It is very important because many times students are confused. Suppose we are moving along this curve, an object is moving along this curve. We take two points very close together. Of course, I will show them a little apart. I can't take them very close because you won't be able to see. But imagine these points A and B are very close together, very near each other. Then the displacement between A and B would be equal to the distance between A and B. The displacement between A and B would be equal to the length AB or the distance between A and B. That means what? That means that at a given point, the instantaneous speed is equal to the magnitude of the instantaneous velocity at that time. Why is it so? Because the displacement is equal to the distance covered. Therefore, the instantaneous velocity, the magnitude of the instantaneous velocity is equal to the speed at that point. This is a very important relation, and you must remember that the instantaneous speed of an object is just the magnitude of its instantaneous velocity. So, you find instantaneous velocity and forget about the direction, the magnitude gives us the speed. Let me repeat this graph again between displacement and time, where the rate of change is increasing upwards. That means the velocity is increasing with time. When velocity increases with time, it means it is not uniform. If the velocity is not uniform, it means that the motion is accelerated. It is obvious that some force must be acting, because if there is no force acting, then the velocity cannot change. So, if the velocity is changing, the motion is accelerated, and obviously some force must be acting on it. The instantaneous acceleration is given by the rate of change of velocity. That is vector A. Remember, acceleration is a vector. So, vector A is equal to dv vector divided by dt. It is the rate of change of velocity vector. Acceleration is the rate of change of velocity vector. And what are the units of acceleration? It is the rate of change of velocity. So, m by s again divided by s. So, it is m divided by s square. So, its units are meter divided by second square, m divided by s square, or m into s raised to power minus 2, as is written many times. Since velocity is a vector quantity, a change in it may imply a change in magnitude or a change in direction. This is again sort of something that confuses students. So let me explain, and please be clear about it. A change in velocity, since velocity has both magnitude and direction, any change in either magnitude or direction or both is a change in v. Let me repeat, since velocity is a vector, it has both direction and magnitude, therefore a change in magnitude or a change in direction or a change in both means a change in v, means an acceleration. So even if the velocity is not changing in magnitude, but its direction is changing, it means that a force is acting on it, that means it has acceleration. If the velocity direction doesn't change, but its magnitude change, that means the velocity continues in the same direction, but its magnitude is changing, increasing or decreasing, that means the motion is accelerated. So the motion is accelerated if either the magnitude of v changes or the direction of v changes or both of them change. Here I take an example, is a circular motion. At each point the velocity vector, although it doesn't change in magnitude if it is uniform circular motion, but its direction changes. If the direction changes, as we have said just now, that means that the motion is accelerated. And if the motion is accelerated, where is the acceleration? Because the velocity magnitude is not changing, that means the acceleration must be in such a direction that it has no component along v, so that the magnitude of v remains constant. And what can this direction be? This direction can be radial. Radial acceleration has no component along v at any point on the circle, and therefore this acceleration, called centripetal acceleration, is along the radius of the circular path, and the velocity at each point of the circular path has the same magnitude. It is not a motion which is under no force. The force is acting, that is why there is acceleration, but the magnitude of velocity is not changing. That is a uniform circular motion. A uniform circular motion, therefore, is not without force. There is a force acting on it, and the force is along the radius, the so called centripetal force. Let us take another example from the game of cricket. You know, the bowler throws a ball, the batsman hits it in some other direction. The ball is coming in this direction, it is going in another direction. That means the ball is accelerated. Why is it accelerated? Because there is a change in direction. And I have been emphasizing that a change in direction or a change in magnitude or both means that the motion is accelerated. So the ball approaching the bat, the ball moving away from the bat, the direction changes, and therefore the motion is accelerated. Why is it accelerated? Because there is the force of the bat. So that makes it accelerated motion. The speed of body falling under gravity. A body is falling under gravity, its speed increases. Its direction is not increasing, it is falling vertically downwards. In this case, it is the magnitude of the velocity that is changing, not the direction. And as I said, a change in magnitude or a change in direction, both mean that the motion is accelerated. So a body falling vertically downwards or a body going up vertically, in both cases the motion is accelerated. And what is the acceleration? In this case, the acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity. And let us have this formula. Acceleration is equal to dv by dt, which is d by dt of ds by dt. So it is d2s by dt square. So if I have the displacement vector s, then differentiating it twice with respect to time, we shall get the acceleration. And an important acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity. It is approximately equal to 10 meters per second square, you know that. The exact value is 9.81 or 9.82 meters per second square. So approximately 10 meters per second square. It is caused by the force of gravitation exerted by the earth on a body. the important thing to remember is that it is always vertically downwards. Again, something that confuses students. Remember, even if the body is going up, the g, the acceleration due to gravity, is acting downwards. If the body is moving downwards, the g is downwards. If the body is moving upwards, even then the acceleration due to gravity is downwards. Acceleration due to gravity is always vertically downwards. Remember this. In other cases, now we shall apply the knowledge that we have gained of vectors and vector algebra and so on to other situations in mechanics. We have so far learnt that acceleration is due to either change in the magnitude of velocity or change in the direction of velocity, or both. These are very important things to remember. And an important acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity, which is approximately equal to 10 meters per second square near the surface of the earth. This is caused by the force of gravitation exerted by the earth on a body. And the important thing to remember that it is always vertically downwards. Sometimes the students are confused. They think that if a body is going up, the acceleration is also in that direction, upwards. No. The acceleration due to gravity is always vertically downwards, whether the body is going up or whether the body is coming down. It is always vertically downwards. And since it has both magnitude and direction, the acceleration due to gravity is a vector quantity. And this concept of vectors, addition, multiplication, etcetera, will be used increasingly now in the coming lectures on mechanics and other topics.